Finally, let's talk about the thematic elements of this late 1970s through the 1980s period. So, first of all, one of the things, and by the way, very few films have all of these aspects. A notable exception is something like Back to the Future, which has almost all of these. But most 80s films have one of these thematic elements. So, first of all, let's talk about the first, which is nostalgia. Now, if you look at the 1970s, you know, whether this is true or not, a lot of people were very, very pessimistic about America and pessimistic about the world and the state of the economy in the 1970s. And there were a number of events that led them to believe that way. So first of all, we did have Vietnam. Vietnam lasted through half of the 1970s. And we also had Watergate, where we had President Nixon covering up crimes by his administration and almost becoming impeached. If he had not resigned, it was likely he was going to be impeached. We also had Arab nations organizing and creating OPEC and basically shutting off the oil supply to the United States, which led to gas shortages and rationing and literally gas stations actually running out of gas. Then, by the end of the decade, we have the Iranian hostage crisis under President Carter, where there was an Iranian revolution in 1979, and 52 Americans were held hostage for over a year in the American embassy. And it seemed like we were very impotent in dealing with that crisis. In fact, here is a news report from that time.
President Carter met with foreign journalists today during an Oval Office news conference. During that meeting, Carter called for support of U.S. allies for sanctions against Iran. He is calling for joint economic sanctions, and if those don't work, the president is asking other countries to break diplomatic relations with Iran. The president is giving our allies a deadline.
You said, Mr. President, you have not much time.
Yes.
Can you give us an idea of timing?
Well, it's not a matter of many weeks, or certainly not a matter of months. It's not appropriate for me now to set a specific date, but we have sent to the heads of nations, all of those represented by you, a specific date at which time we would expect this common effort to be successful.
Some American allies warned Iran today that they will follow American sanction policies unless the hostages are released by a certain date. The ambassadors of European common market nations and Japan delivered those warnings during a meeting with Iranian President Bani Sadr. Well, Sadr apparently rejected the ambassadors' demands, but said the hostages would receive visitors from the Red Cross and health care. Bani Sadr said that only his parliament of his country can free the hostages, and the parliament of that country has not yet been elected.
So if you look at the 1970s, this in many ways seemed like it was a very depressing era, and there was a desire to return to a previous era. Now, the 1950s had its share of problems, but one of the things the 1950s had was a very robust economy. And so you see a lot of films that are looking back at the 1950s and the early 1960s. So just look at this list. So first of all, we get Greece in 1978 and Greece 2 in 1982, and these are looking at a period in the late 1950s, early 1960s. We get Raiders of the Lost Ark, which I think is probably the only film that nostalgically looks back at the 1930s, basically the era of the rise of the Nazis and the Great Depression, and yet it's still looking back at this era. We get Peggy Sue Got Married, which is a Francis Ford Coppola film from the 1980s, and it deals with a woman in the 1980s who is divorced from her ex-husband, and she finds herself back in her teenage body in the early 1960s and has to decide whether or not to have a relationship that she knows will ultimately fail. And then, of course, maybe the quintessential 1980s film is Back to the Future, which is set in 1955 for the most part. And in fact, it gives a strong contrast. If you go back and look at the image, the beginning of this section on thematic elements, you can actually see the contrast. So in 1955, when Marty McFly sees the Essex Theater, they're showing a Ronald Reagan, Barbara Stanwyck film, Cattle Queen of Montana. If, on the other hand, you go back and you look at the Essex Theater in 1985, it's showing Orgy American Style. And so you can actually see this commentary on how things have changed and how much more wholesome the past was. Continuing on, we get Stand By Me by Rob Reiner, his fourth film, which was a successful film based on a Stephen King short story, and yet it's set in 1959, and even though there is a dead body these boys find, it's seen as more of an idyllic time to be existing. We get La Bamba, which deals with Ritchie Valens, one of the three rock and rollers to die in an Iowa plane crash in Clearfield, Iowa. And that's set in the 1950s, of course. And then maybe the most ironic is the John Waters film Hairspray. Now, John Waters is a filmmaker who has always kind of been on the edge. And his previous success prior to this point was an exploitation film called Pink Flamingos, where basically it's a contest for the most disgusting human beings alive or something along those lines, and it actually has one of the characters eat a real dog poop. And that was actually its drawing point, is to show how disgusting the film was. So John Waters, however, even though he was always on the edge, when he made Hairspray, this is the version before it became a musical, it looks back on this early 1962 period with a certain amount of affection. So even as it acknowledges the problem with racial segregation, it still is looking at this as more of an idyllic time. Now, here's a clip from Back to the Future just to show you this contrast. So Marty McFly is coming in to Hill Valley in 1955 for the first time. The next theme deals with consumerism and particularly wealth and acquisition of wealth. So you get a lot of films from this period where the main characters, their driving goal is to become rich. And these are very formulaic films. So what we often get is we have, at the beginning of the film, people who have power, people who have money that we do not like, that are unethical, they're elitist. Or in some cases, as we saw in Romancing the Stone, dangerous. And the whole point of the film is, how do we transfer the money from people we don't like to people we do like? And this is a big difference from films in the past. Now, this is not to say that Hollywood was never interested in money. They've always been interested in money. But at least in terms of their narratives, in terms of their stories, it tended to be the cliche of money being the root of all evil. And once we get to the 1980s, you actually see in the substance of these films, at least in the universe of these films, money itself is not evil. It's only people who are evil. And it's the point of the film is to get the money away from the evil people to the people we like. And the people don't tend to rebel against the system. They actually tend to work within the system. So, Trading Places. We have two individuals, the Duke brothers, who are very wealthy, run a Wall Street investment firm, and they're incredibly unethical. In fact, they ruin one of their employees' lives and pick someone off the street, played by Eddie Murphy, and they basically have them switch places. They frame their former employee, who was a model employee, for crimes, and so he loses his fortune, and meanwhile give him his house and his butler and his lifestyle to this other person based on a $1 bet. Now, their ultimate goal is they're going to destroy both these people's lives once the experiment is over. But they're seeing whether or not good behavior is based on evolution or upbringing. You know, it's the classic, which is it? You know, are people born to be criminal, or are criminals developed by society? Arthur is a film that came a couple years before Trading Places, but has similar themes. So Arthur himself, the major character, is an heir to a major fortune. He happens to be an alcoholic, but we kind of like him. Now, his family, headed by his grandmother, expects him to marry a particular woman who is a member of another financially successful family so that they can merge the finances. Arthur, though, has fallen in love with a common woman that he observes shoplifting, and has fallen in love with her and wants to marry her. And so the main key, the main point of the film is, how do they get the fortune away from the grandmother and restore, even though he wants to be with a woman he loves, so that Arthur and the woman he loves don't have to be poor. And that happens during the course of the film. 9 to 5 deals more with real people. So you have people who are secretaries, who work at a firm, under a boss played by Dabney Coleman. And the Dabney Coleman character is completely incompetent and quite cruel. And through the course of many different occurrences in the film, they basically have him kidnapped, and the secretaries run the business. And they actually run the business better than he does. And ultimately, even though there is some complications, he gets shipped out, basically sent to South America, and they end up in control of the company. Caddyshack. Caddyshack is a really interesting film, because if you look at it, supposedly it's about the kid trying to get a college scholarship, and yet that is not what most people remember about the film. Most people remember about the film being a conflict between the rich people we like, which is, you know, people like Chevy Chase and Rodney Dangerfield, and the people that we don't like, people like the character played by Ted Knight. One of the most disturbing aspects about the concentration on gaining financial wealth that occurs in these films is the use of prostitution. This necessitates a discussion about the different types of conservatism. So if you're a social conservative, you are more concerned about personal behavior, especially regarding sexual actions. However, if you are a fiscal conservative, if you're more of a libertarian conservative, this does not concern you. It's more about financial situations. And when I say these films are conservative, I'm talking actually more on the libertarian end. So the thing about prostitution in pre-1980s films is prostitution was often seen as an evil. So even in a film from the 1970s, at the time that sexuality was being exploited by Hollywood, you do get a film like Clute, where it's very obvious that prostitution is not a positive in Jane Fonda's character's life. Yet by the time we get to the 1980s, prostitution is portrayed in many of these films as being an unconventional business, but not any different than if you're opening up a dry cleaner's, other than the fact that it's illegal. So if we look at Trading Places, for example, the Jamie Lee Curtis character is a prostitute, and she literally sets out a business plan. Her business plan is if she lies on her back for a few years, she can bank the money and then turn around the money and invest it and retire off of it. Now, a couple major films are a little more explicit in their prostitution theme. So Ron Howard's second feature, after he left the Corman School, is Night Shift. And basically, Night Shift finds Henry Winkler, through all sorts of circumstances, being pushed into becoming a pimp, where they run a brothel out of a morgue. Now, very similar theme, and a very successful film, Risky Business, which brought us Tom Cruise as a major actor, it's a similar type of situation. So instead of it being operated out of a morgue, it's being operated out of his parents' house, where his parents are on vacation, and he's using it not to invest for the future as a business decision, but basically to come up with money so he can go to college. So here what we have is a very, very long clip, but I think a clip that really defines how important finances are in 1980 cinema. This is most of the ending from Trading Places. Now, in this clip, the Duke brothers, we had mentioned earlier, they invest in many different things. They're commodities brokers, and they have gotten a secret government report on the orange crops. And one of the things you can basically invest in is frozen concentrated orange juice. So they think they know how the market is going to go. So they're doing insider trading. Our main characters, who have found out about this $1 bet that ruined one person's life and temporarily elevated another person, but ultimately leads to the destruction of both of them, they're looking for revenge. And they're also looking to make money. So they get the original frozen concentrated orange juice report, the government report, and they give a false report to the Duke brothers. And knowing that, they're also doing insider trading, but they are going to be successful, whether the Duke brothers or not. So here is the clip.
My life savings, try not to lose it.
Lose it? Coleman, in a couple hours, you're gonna be the richest butler that ever lived, man.
I worked real hard for this, Louis. Hope you know what you're doing.
Thank you, Ophelia.
What are you doing?
That's us, Louis. New York and Boston.
Coleman, would you please? Thank you. Use a stiff drink. Would you get a joint?
Good morning, Mr. Duke.
Keep the change. Think big. Think positive. Never show any sign of weakness. Always go for the throat. Buy low, sell high. Fear, that's the other guy's problem. Nothing you have ever experienced can prepare you for the unbridled carnage you're about to witness. Right. Super Bowl, the World Series, they don't know what pressure is. In this building, it's either kill or be killed. Right. You make no friends in the pits and you take no prisoners.
No prisoners.
1 minute, you're up $500,000 in soybeans, and the next, boom, your kids don't go to college and they've repossessed your Bentley. Are you with me?
Yeah, but we gotta kill them, motherfucker! We gotta kill them!
We want you to buy as much OJ as you can the instant trading starts.
Don't worry if the price starts going up, just keep buying.
But, gentlemen, they're going to broadcast the crop report in an hour. What if they're...
Let us worry about that, Wilson.
Yes, sir.
How's the ulcer, Harry?
Pretty good. How's the hypertension?
Hasn't bothered me in months.
Thank you.
Let's kick some ass. Bastion of pure capitalism left on earth. Here in New York, they trade everything. Gold, silver, platinum, heating oil, propane, cocoa and sugar, and of course, frozen concentrated orange juice. Now the people on the phones are taking orders from brokerage houses all over the world. The runners then hand those orders to the traders in the pits. They're trading cotton over there. That's the silver pit. Now, the Duke's trader is going to be buying like crazy right from the opening.
We'll be waiting until he drives the price up.
Right. I can't wait to see his face when they broadcast that genuine crop report. OJ trading opens at 9.
Let's go kick some butt.
Let's go.
Hey, the Dukes are trying to corner the market.
They know something. I can feel it.
Let's get in on it.
200, take them.
130!
200, 200.
Move it.
Not yet. Almost.
220, take them. 209!
Yeah, yeah, got them.
139! 140!
Hey, to me, living up to the
now.
Sell down in April of 142!
That's not right. How can the price be going down?
Something's wrong. Where's Wilson?
What are they doing here?
They're selling, Mortimer.
Why, that's ridiculous. Unless that crop report...
God help us!
I told you we shouldn't have committed everything, you asshole!
I've got to get Wilson and tell him to sell!
Ladies and gentlemen, the orange crop estimates for the next year. After calculating the estimates from various orange-producing states, we have concluded the following. The cold winter has apparently not affected the orange harvest. Consumers can expect orange and orange juice prices to fall if it remains.
get in there at once and sell, sell.
But I just...
Five?
Yeah,
100.
Oh, yeah, that was
100.
100? So, did you get that?
I got five with you, man.
Oh, that was 100 lots?
100?
That's 25. Happy New Year!
Winthrop.
Valentine.
Hey, how'd y'all make out today?
How could you do this to us after everything we've done for you?
Oh, see, I made Lewis a bet here. The Lewis bet me that we couldn't both get rich and put y'all in the poorhouse at the same time. He didn't think we could do it. I won.
I lost. $1.
Thank you, Lewis.
After you.
Certainly.
Margin call, gentlemen. Oh, you can't expect us to...
You know the rules of the exchange, Mr. Duke. All accounts to be settled at the end of the day's trading, without exception.
You know perfectly well we don't have $394 million in cash.
I'm sorry, boys. Put the Duke brothers' seats on the exchange up for sale at once. Seize all assets of Duke and Duke Commodities Brokers, as well as all personal holdings of Randolph and Mortimer Duke.
My God, we're ruined.
This is an outrage. I demand an investigation. You can't sell our seats. A duke has been sitting on this exchange since it was founded. We founded this exchange. It's ours. It belongs to us.
My God.
Mortimer, your brother's not well. We better call an ambulance.
Fuck him. Now you listen to me. I want trading reopened right now. Get those brokers back in here. Turn those machines back on. Turn those machines back on.
The third theme is the resurrection of military honor. And the really interesting thing about films made during the Vietnam War is very few of them actually discussed the war while the war was occurring. One of the major notable exceptions to this is John Wayne's The Green Berets from 1968. Now, this stands in contrast to films made during World War II. In World War II, there were many films that were produced about the war while the war was continuing. So, Vietnam was not a very popular subject. And in fact, it took years before Vietnam directly appeared on the screen. Now, in the interim, it's not like the war was completely non-existent. There were films like MASH, where if you look at the characters, they're very much Vietnam-era characters, but they were set in the Korean War rather than the Vietnam War. So even though the film is more about the Vietnam experience than the Korean experience, basically it was more safe to discuss it by putting it into a previous conflict. Now, the first films about Vietnam came at the end of the 70s, but interestingly, the first couple didn't actually directly deal with the war. So you get Coming Home. Coming Home is about a Vietnam veteran who's a paraplegic and his experiences in adjusting to American society after serving in the war. Similarly, we get The Deer Hunter, which won Best Picture that same year, 1978. And while there are a few scenes set in Vietnam, most of it is once again about adjusting, about veterans adjusting back into normal American society. And it isn't until Apocalypse Now in 1979 that we get the first film about Vietnam that is actually set in Vietnam since John Wayne's The Green Berets. And Apocalypse Now is a generally negative view of the war. Now, a little digression here. Apocalypse Now was actually slated to be shot during the Vietnam War. And in fact, George Lucas was supposed to be the director. And their plan was is to actually go to Vietnam while the war was being fought and film the film. And it almost happened, but fortunately a very intelligent Hollywood executive decided that all these filmmakers were crazy and they were going to get themselves killed, so the project got postponed until Francis Ford Coppola took it up in the mid to late 70s. Now, we get to the 1980s. And the attitude towards the military, which had generally been negative during the end of the 1970s, switches, and it starts showing the military in a more positive light. So we, in 1981, we get the film Taps, where basically people who are attending a military school, when the school is threatened with closure, they basically take over the school because of the lessons, the life lessons the military has taught them. Next year, we get An Officer and a Gentleman, where you get someone who is kind of an unethical, only looks out for himself, relic of the hippie era, who goes in under basic training and under a very strict drill sergeant who is strict but also cares about his cadets, basically morphs from being very, very selfish to basically selfless and working for the benefit of others by the end. So it's a very positive experience for him. The Right Stuff, which is about the early NASA astronauts, is also about the military, since all the early astronauts were in fact from the Navy and the Air Force. And it has very similar themes. And of course there's Top Gun. Top Gun, once again, you have Tom Cruise's character, and they change as they are trained. So then we have the comedies, and we get to Private Benjamin. Private Benjamin has Goldie Hawn as a rich heiress whose husband dies on their wedding night in a kind of funny but maybe inappropriate to talk about way, and she decides to join the army. And she goes from actually being a rich, spoiled heiress to a fully functioning human being. And very similarly, the next year we have Stripes with Bill Murray and Harold Ramis, and a similar thing happens. Bill Murray's character and Harold Ramis's character are barely functioning in American society. They join the military. They have a drill sergeant who pushes them hard. They rebel, but eventually they come to see his way, and they end up as more functional human beings at the end of the film. And then finally, I always like to talk about science fiction, because most people talk about science fiction as if it's fantasy about the future, and there's certainly an element of that. But when you really are talking about science fiction, it's always talking about the present time when the film was made as an allegory. So we get Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan. And in Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, Kirk finds out he has a son, and his son is basically a scientist, but he kind of leans on the edge of having hippie ideals and is very distrustful of the Federation because he's distrustful of the military. And by the end of the film, he comes to appreciate Kirk as his father and respect what the Federation is doing. So this is a big change in how the military is seen. Finally, we have the Rambo films. And the interesting thing about the Rambo films is the best you can describe the Vietnam experience as for America is that we had a draw where basically neither North Vietnam nor the Americans completely won. You know, in many ways, we kind of both lost. But that doesn't fit well with Hollywood mythology. So with the Rambo films, we finally win the Vietnam War with Rambo First Blood Part 2 as he goes back. Now, here's a clip from An Officer and a Gentleman to show you a character who was very, very selfish at the beginning of the film has changed. So while he has a potential for personal glory, he sacrifices that personal glory in order to help one of his compatriots.
Go. Last chance for the record. Go.
Go.
Go
for the record, Theo.
This is it, Mayonnaise. Go.
Go for it now! Go get it! You got it!
Let's go, Mayo! Push it!
Get there, Mayo! Put your name on that wall, Mayo! Put your name on that wall!
Let's do this together, Seeger.
It's
Singer.
Forget it. Just go for the record.
Come on.
Come on. You got it.
Hey. Come
on.
Hey.
Get it.
Hey.
Where are
you going?
Get
up. Forget it. You are judge. Get up. You're going over that wall. Right here. You're gonna start right here. Three steps. Right, left, right. Head over head, walk the wall. So stand on your mark.
Come on, Seagull!
Ready? Let's go! Left, right, out, pull! Walk that wall, Seagull! Walk it! Walk the wall! Head over head! Head over head! Walk it! Walk it! Walk the wall! Walk it, Seagull! Seagull, walk! Seagull! Don't let go! You walk that wall, pull! Go! Pull, Kennedy, Seagull! Pull! Pull, pull, you got it. Now pull off. Pull over. Pull yourself over. We're safe.
So next, let's talk about the intensification of Cold War tensions. Now, we'd already talked about the Cold War. We talked about it during the end of the 1940s, through the 50s and the 60s. And this starts to change a little bit in the 1970s for the better. And ironically, it's the Richard Nixon administration that brings us many of these changes through détente. This is really ironic if you remember that Richard Nixon built his career as a Cold Warrior and was on the House Un-American Activities Committee, the one that basically brought in people from Hollywood and accused them of being communists. His administration actually lessened the tension between many communist nations and the United States. So, first of all, Nixon and his administration normalized the relationship with China, Nixon even going to China to meet with Mao Zedong, which would have been unheard of years before. The Nixon administration, along with the Soviets, negotiated the SALT I Treaty, which limited the number of strategic ballistic missile launchers to whatever the level was in 1972. That continued through the Ford administration into the Carter administration, where Carter's administration negotiated SALT II, which banned any new missile programs. And even though this was never actually ratified by Congress, for the most part, for many years after 1979, both the Soviet Union and the United States followed this, even into the beginning years of the Reagan administration. Now, what changes this is a number of events. In 1979, the Soviet Union invades Afghanistan. And of course, we know what a good idea it is to invade Afghanistan. Also in 1979, the Sandinistas overthrow the Somoza regime in Nicaragua, which makes the United States very nervous, having a new socialist government in the Western Hemisphere for the first time since Cuba. Our reaction to these events is in 1980, we ban our American athletes from competing in the Moscow Summer Olympics, which to this day there are athletes who were supposed to compete who are very, very bitter about this.
But our top story tonight is the Summer Olympics. Simply put, there will not be any for the United States. Vice President Walter Mondale today convinced the United States Olympic Committee to boycott the Summer Games in Moscow. He said there's no longer a choice between sports and national security. Mondale pictured the boycott as a test of American will, confidence, values, and power.
As you also, I'm sure, know, that it is a vote for President Carter's viewpoint. And United States Olympic Committee, I believe, is supporting him in a substantial way.
The vote was 2-1 to boycott the Summer Olympic Games, the committee meeting today in Colorado. In Washington, President Carter reacted warmly to the news. He welcomed the boycott that he has pushed so hard in recent months, ever since the Soviets invaded Afghanistan.
So all those events happened under the Carter administration. Now, the Reagan administration comes in, One of the first things that happens is they accelerate the arms race. We start spending more on weapon systems. The Soviet Union feels it has to as well. And the Reagan administration initially refers to the Soviet Union as the evil empire. Now let's talk about this as a practical tactic politically. It may be, in fact, that the Soviet Union was an evil empire. But if you refer to them as such, are they likely to negotiate with you? And the answer is very likely no. That basically this is a way of shutting off communications between the two superpowers. And that is pretty much what happened. Now you can see this, and I'm a big fan of James Bond films. If you want to actually look at American-Soviet relations or American-Russian relations or America's relations to the rest of the world, you can look at it through James Bond films, even though Bond films tend to be a British thing. There's enough connection between the United Kingdom and the United States that we have similar issues. So if you look in 1977 with the James Bond film The Spy Who Loved Me, or Roger Moore was the actor who played Bond, basically this was at the height of detente when tensions between the Soviet Union, the United States, and the United Kingdom had lessened to the point where the film is about a Soviet agent collaborating with James Bond to recover a lost nuclear weapon. Now, it probably didn't hurt, because it's a Bond film, that the Soviet agent was female, but this was very, very different from the Sean Connery Cold War era Bond films in the 1960s. Now, Soviets invade Afghanistan, and all of a sudden, just a few years later, 1981, we get another great Roger Moore Bond film with For Your Eyes Only, and they even create a brand new Soviet character who basically just exists to stand there and laugh at James Bond. And the Soviets are competing with the British in the recovery of a British encryption device. So we go from being cooperative to being rivals once again. Now, there are all sorts of films where the Soviets or Soviet-aligned countries or China emerge as a threatening force. So in basically 1982, we get a Clint Eastwood film called Firefox. Stripes, which treats Soviet-allied countries like Czechoslovakia as a threat. We get Red Dawn, where the Soviets actually land in Kansas and try to take over the United States. White Nights, where we have a ballet dancer attempting to leave the Soviet Union. And then, of course, we get Rocky IV, where Rocky, representing the United States, takes on a genetically modified fighter from the Soviet Union. And then, of course, Top Gun. We never actually see the Soviets, but we sure see their planes a lot. So we have all these films that have very, very similar themes where the Russians are on the opposite side. Now, this is a clip from Red Dawn that I mentioned before, where the Soviets land in Kansas as part of a plot to take over the United States.
And it went on until the young son of the Khan asked his father that the last creature alive.
Be allowed to go free. Well now, my friend. Well now.
Oh, check it out.
All right.
Look pretty cool though, man.
I would say they were way off course. This is very unusual.
You can do something, Mr. Teasdale.
What's going on,
my friend? Come on, let's go!
along with these films that increase the tension between the Soviet Union and the United States, which was felt in American society at that time, that there was this tension, there also was the fear of what could possibly happen because of this tension. You know, we nearly went to an atomic war during the 1960s with the Cuban Missile Crisis. Something like that could potentially happen again. And we started getting films where there's a lot of anxiety about the fact that we all had a lot of nuclear weapons pointed at each other. So there's a whole nuclear Holocaust film cycle that appears during this decade. So in British television, we get Threads, which deals with British society after a nuclear exchange. The American version of this was The Day After, which was so influential at the time that it actually, once Ronald Reagan had seen it as president, that was the moment that he decided that he needed to work on reducing the threat of nuclear weapons. So the stuff that was mentioned earlier in the Rachel Maddow clip emerges here based on this particular film. We get Testament, which is a low-budget film, doesn't have a lot of exploding bombs, but it actually is probably the most realistic and heart-wrenching of all these films. And then the commercial success is War Games, in which a young teenager hacks into a military computer and nearly starts World War III. And then, once again, science fiction, like I said, is rarely about the future. It's mostly about the present put in as allegory in the future. And if you look at the Terminator series films, Terminator and Terminator 2 Judgment Day, underneath that, you know, underneath the plot of machines preparing to wipe out humanity, you have this threat of nuclear war, which is much more explicit in Terminator 2 than it is in the first Terminator film. Here is a clip from The Day After.
What's going on?
Those are Minuteman missiles.
Like a test, sort of. Like a warning?
They're on their way to Russia. They take about 30 minutes to reach their target.
So do theirs, right?
Missile warning, this is Beale. Confidence is high. I repeat, confidence is high. Roger, we've got 32 targets in track and 10 impacting points. I want to confirm, is this an exercise? Roger, copy. This is not an exercise.
Roger, understand. Major Reinhardt, we have a massive attack against the U.S. at this time. ICBMs. Numerous ICBMs. Roger, understand. Over 300 missiles inbound now.
Come on, baby, don't die on me now. Oh.
Oh.
Another 1980s theme is the theme of rejuvenation and redemption. And if you look at the 1970s, this is where, because of events during the 1970s, American self-confidence was at its all-time low. There was more self-doubt than anything else. So this transforms in the 1980s to once again having self-confidence, along with the election of Ronald Reagan. And a lot of films from this period reflect this change by having rejuvenation. So here are some films. For example, E.T., one of the biggest films of all time, and certainly the biggest film of the 1980s, E.T. dies, and yet at a certain point, he comes back to life. He's rejuvenated. He's resurrected. Cocoon, which is a Ron Howard film, has a bunch of elderly people, and they end up swimming, at first by accident and then on purpose, in an alien pool, which gives them life-renewing abilities. So they become younger again. They become rejuvenated. And even one of the characters who had been diagnosed with terminal cancer no longer has the cancer. And we're going to see a clip from that in a minute. And then again, Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, spoilers here, Spock dies at the end of Star Trek II, but in Star Trek III, The Search for Spock, he obviously is resurrected. So here's that clip from Cocoon.
And they didn't give you any other medication at all over at the home, huh?
Not a thing, Doc.
Well, Joe, I gotta tell you, I have never seen anything like this before in my life. It's a... Well, it's a miracle. It's a complete remission.
I just love to see you eat your words, Doc. You want to arm wrestle?
Oh. How about that?
Finally, one of the most important themes in 1980s cinema has to do with the importance of family, particularly with reconnecting with fathers. Now, this happens because in the 1970s and 1980s, we have the baby boomers, which up to that point had been the largest generation in history. They are finally of an age to get married and have kids of their own. And so once you have this generation having their own children, the division between families that happened during the Vietnam War, where children and parents did not agree and it led to arguments in families and in some cases, children not fighting in the war and going to Canada, for example. Eventually what happens is if you have children of your own, you want to mend those particular divisions in your family. And the parents who become grandparents also want to mend those divisions. So we start getting films about families at this point. So Kramer versus Kramer is about a custody battle. This is from 1979. Mr. Mom, which basically switches domestic roles between men and women, once again because of children. Three Men and a Baby, kind of a similar situation, only with bachelors basically taking care of a child. And then we get Raising Arizona, which, even though it's directed by the Coen brothers, who tend to make somewhat edgier material, deals with a family where a police officer woman and an ex-con that she marries, they can't have children on their own, they kidnap a child and take care of it. So even though the Coen brothers tend to be cult filmmakers, here they are in the 1980s playing to the themes present in other 1980s films. Then there is Baby Boom from 1987, where it has Diane Keaton's character balancing her career with wanting to raise a child. And we also get Look Who's Talking, which is the one shining moment in John Travolta's career between Saturday Night Fever in Grease and eventually Pulp Fiction, but where it's all about raising a child. And then finally, at the end of the decade, we get Ron Howard's Parenthood, which deals with the problems of various different families. This all falls into the fact that the baby boomer generation was growing up. The other part of this has to do with the split that I mentioned before between the baby boomer generation and the World War II generation, particularly between sons and fathers. So one of the earliest examples of this, there's a film made for television called The Gathering, where the son has gone off to Canada to avoid the draft. The father is very angry about his son not serving in Vietnam. But the father finds out later on, after it's basically been revealed to him that Vietnam was not the war he thought it was, that the father develops terminal cancer and he wants to connect with his son. So we get this connection between these children and these parents, starting with, as an early example, this made-for-television Christmas movie. So look at this list of films, some of which have been very, very financially successful films in the 1980s. Back to the Future. If you think about Back to the Future, isn't it Marty McFly, who does not respect his parents in 1985, goes back in time and comes to respect them as teenagers in 1955 and sees that respect pay off later on? On Golden Pond, which ironically was not only about a daughter connecting with her father in the film, but Jane Fonda had purchased this play, produced the film, to have her own father star in the role along with her. And so this was her actual gesture to kind of reconnect a broken relationship in real life as well as in the film. And of course, as a Star Wars fan, we have to mention Return of the Jedi, which is really more than anything about Darth Vader reconnecting with Luke Skywalker as father and son. And then, as in a similar vein, along with the Lucas Spielberg realm, we also get Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, which has a similar thing with Indiana Jones and his father, played by Sean Connery, having a very troubled relationship at the beginning of the film and reconnecting by the end. And now, one last thing. We also have the surrogate fathers. So if you look at a film like Rocky, Rocky's trainer has a very, very difficult relationship with Rocky Balboa. And they act as almost like father and son, even as much as they are trainer and boxer. And by the end of that film, they have come to respect each other. Similarly, we have the individual entering basic training along with the drill sergeant, where the drill sergeant acts like a father figure and the person entering basic training acts as a errant son. And they have a very difficult relationship at the beginning of the film, and by the end of the film, they have reconciled that and have a much stronger relationship as surrogate father and child. Now you can see this in the comedy Stripes, as well as the serious film, An Officer and a Gentleman. And then finally, E.T. If you look at E.T., they spend an awful lot of time showing how much Elliot doesn't have a father figure in his life. And if you look at the evolution of the alien E.T. throughout the film, he becomes more and more as a paternal figure as the film goes on. Here is a clip from Stripes.
Getting the idea, Winger, that you don't like me.
Maybe I just don't know you well enough yet, Sarge.
What do you say? Let's cut out the bullshit between you and me, huh?
Let's.
I think you're a punk. I've been in this army 28 years. I've seen your kind come and go. You think you know something about everything, don't you? Well, let me tell you something, mister. You don't know a damn thing about soldiering.
Oh, it's real tough stuff, Sarge, especially that marching in a straight line business. That's...
I ain't talking about that crap. I'm talking about something important, like discipline and duty and honor and courage. And you ain't got none of it.
Those words mean so much to a man who scrubs garbage cans. Look, if you don't want me in your army, kick me out, but get off my back.
Maybe you'd like to take a swing at me.
I'd like to take a big swing at you, Sarge.
Well, go ahead and give it your best shot.
I don't think I want to go to the stockade.
I'll take my hat off. There we are, Winger. Ain't no more drill, Sergeant. It's just you and me, kid, man to man. So go ahead, give it your best shot. Swing at me. Gutless. Punk.
I'm willing to forget about this little incident. And I want you to think real hard about it. And maybe someday you'll understand what the hell I'm talking about.